Oh, yeah. You are amazing. Amen. Oh, yeah. That's what he is. He is amazing. And we thank him for being amazing. Amen. I don't know about you, but here and there and around and about, I often would sit and just think about me and God. God and me. And I'm just always awed that who he is and who I am, and he decides to be involved, to be a part of my life, to be a part of my being and my doing. I'm just awed by that fact. Then I look at the things that he has done with my life, and I look at the things that he is doing in my life, and I'm like, wow, God. You know, if you're not ever taking those kind of inventories, maybe you think it's you. Maybe you think you did it, but there are some things, Chris, that happens in my life. I look at him and say, like, man, wow. For me, you did this. For me, this is happening. Yeah. I know a lot of folk I could call, but there are some things that phone calls can't get through to. That there are some people that have told me that this is out of my reach, but God still does those amazing things for me. Yeah. And I'm more and more humbled by the fact that he's choosing me every day. He's choosing me every day. I'm humbled by that. Yeah. Now, I can look at that and say, you're amazing. You're amazing. Yep. Okay. Let me come down some. But it's just kind of odd to me to know that every good and perfect gift does come down from the Father above. And that every day I think about him, I have more and more to thank him for. Amen. There's a scripture in Job chapter 42. I want to begin reading at verse number 10, and I want to go on to verse number 17, which is the conclusion of chapter 42. I wish that we had the time this morning to start at verse number 1 and go all the way through 17, because there's so many nuggets that's above this particular section that I think is so important for us fully gleaning the text. So let's start at verse number 10. So Eliphaz, the Temanite, and Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite, went and did according as the Lord commanded them. The Lord also accepted Job. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job when Job prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job 2 times as much as he had before. Y'all need to catch that. The next word gets me. Then came there unto him. Catch this next word, because it really means this. All his brethren and all his sisters and all they that had been of his acquaintance before Can you say everybody? Not everybody, everybody. And did eat bread with him in his house. And they, everybody, bemoaned him or grieved with him and comforted him over all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. Every man also, somebody say also, gave him a piece of money. And everyone an earring of gold. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. For he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, and 1,000 yoke of oxen, team of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys, she asses. He had also 7 sons, 3 daughters. And he called the name of first Jemima, the name of the second Keziah, and the name of the third, what's her name? Carrying Hapak. In all the land were no women found as fair as the daughters of Job. Those are some good looking girls. And their father gave them an inheritance. Men, y'all hear that? Did y'all just hear that? And their father gave them an inheritance among their brethren. After this lived Job 140 years and saw his sons and his sons' sons, even 4 generations. So Job died being old and full of days. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let those out then. While you think about what you want from God. What you need him to do. What you cannot do for yourself. Maybe it's okay with you, but you got somebody that's been calling you. Talking to you about some things. And saying to you, I just can't wait for things to get better. Well, you know a God that can make things better. So this morning you can get on the main line and tell him what you want. I remember praying some 20 years ago for a friend of mine who was in dire need of God revealing himself in her darkness and in her calamities. And I remember saying to God, God, according to my faith, would you reveal your hand? I remember telling God, she has some hang-ups. She's caught in her darkness. She's caught in how bad things are. She's caught up in the difficulties and it's hard for her to see and even to believe. But according to my faith, would you reveal yourself? And I want you to know that God did it. God did it. I say that because I want you to be encouraged to know that God will answer for the things you desire for you, but he will also answer for the things you desire for others. That's enough to shout about all by itself. So while you have gathered your thoughts and set aside and say, what the heck? I'm just going to ask him anyway. What could happen if I ask him? Yeah, what could happen if I ask him? What I got to lose by talking to him? Let's pray. Oh God, we come this morning and our hearts are made glad that here it is, God, another month in a new year that you blessed us to come over into. We're excited about the fact that, God, you keep on ruling and guiding. Keep on protecting and sustaining. Keep on providing. Keep on opening doors and sending forth your light and your truth. You continue to heal. You continue to deliver. You continue, oh God, to make ways out of no way. You continue, God, to just prove yourself mighty over and over again. And for that, we're thankful. We thank you for being a God that accompanies his people, the God that looks after his people, the God that put not his people to shame, the God that fights their battles and stand alongside them and say, this is my child. He's mine. We thankful for the valleys of shadow of death that we've gone through. We thank you for the tables that you prepared for us in the presence of our enemies. Thank you, O God, that our valleys were not too deep or our deserts too dry for you to come and be with us. Even at our own will and our own fault and our own doing, you did not, God, leave us alone. So when we were in despair and at our weakest moment, you heard our faintest cry and you answered by and by. We thank you for being attentive to our prayers and having your eyes upon us and knowing our standing up and our sitting down, knowing our going out and our coming in. Thank you for being so interested in us. And thank you for investing in us. We pray, oh God, we praise you for your grace that you've extended. And for mercies, not that's recycled, but mercies that are new every morning. We thank you for your hands of benevolence, and we thank you for your hands of blessings. But more, we thank you for your heart of love that you show toward us, because behind the curtains, what are you really doing and why are you doing what you're doing? It's because you love us. Even me, you love. We're thankful. You have caused our plans to succeed. You have blessed the works of our hands. You've expanded our borders. And you've been faithful to us. We thank you. We thank you. There's not a friend, no, not like the Lord Jesus. No, not one. We thank you for this day of another chance. We thank you for just another opportunity to renew our love for you, to refine our dedication and commitment to you. We thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for this opportunity to worship you as Lord and God, as the one that none can compare to, to the one that we bow ourselves to in humility and reverence and in awe. There's so much of you to be consumed, so much of you to know, so much of you to try to wrap our minds around. And yet, while we have one thing unfolding, you are revealing something new. Thank you for being the lover of our souls. Thank you for being our mighty, our counselor. Thank you for being our everlasting Father. Our hope in ages past, our shield from the stormy blast. Thank you, oh God. So we offer to you what we have, fragile lives, battered, torn, weary, but we lay it at your feet and say, I'm thine, O Lord. Do what you will with these clay vessels. But more than anything, be glorified in us as you fashion and unfold us. Renew our mind and our spirit. And give that fire in our hearts, that we may sing the song, just to be close to you is our desire. Grant us thy peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things. Great things. I'm expecting great things. I'm expecting great things, great things. In my home,
in my home,
you do great things,
you do great things.
In my life,
expecting great things. Where are you that are expecting great things? Yes, indeed. Oh, yeah. Oh, yes, yes, yes. All around. Personal. Yes, indeed. I'm expecting great things. There are some things I want to do with other folk, but when it comes to what I need in my life, I just need me and God on the same page. Amen. Amen. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless you, oh God. Bless you, oh God. Bless you, oh God. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right, let's try to get into this word. Job chapter 42. And I want to read in your hearing verses 10 through 13. Eyes haven't seen. I choose to believe great things. Eyes haven't seen. I choose to believe great things. When you got it, say, I got it. Still looking, say, I'm looking. Amen. Reading from a King James version of the Bible, here are the words that we'll find. And the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Then came there unto him all his brethren and all his sisters and all they that had been of his acquaintance before, and did eat bread with him in his house. And they bemoaned him and comforted him over all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. Every man also gave him a piece of money. and every one an earring of gold. And the Lord, so the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 she asses. He had also 7 sons and 3 daughters. I want to talk today from the subject that I'll bounce back. Maybe I need to break those words up. I will bounce back. I hate to ask you to do this, but I just want you to do it anyway. Can you look at somebody and tell them in a declarative statement, I will bounce back? Yeah, I will bounce back. Yeah. I got to admit that I'm going through some things. I got to admit that things are not where I want them to be. I admit that I feel downtrodden and I feel that I've been left out, but I want you to know that although all of these things are happening in my life, I will bounce back. Folk done walked out on me. Folk done left me. Folk seem like they've forgotten about me. Folk have talked about me. Folk still lying on me. Folk still counting me out, even though I feel desolate, abandoned, and alone and hurt. I want you to know all that heaped up together. My inward person is telling me I will bounce back. I must admit to you that Gary Adams refused to accept that God would allow him to die in loneliness, to die in poverty, to die broken, to die in a place that is an embarrassment to his King and his Lord. I can't accept that God would leave me in a place like this when there's so much more of him to be gained. No. I must say, it's true. I've been through some hard times. And I will face more hard times. But whatever is what you're calling a setback, it's only God preparing me for a comeback. Let me go ahead and talk to me, because I need this today. I need you to understand that you don't need to look at me. And I said something to somebody the other day that called me, accountability person, called me. You know, sometimes I get stuck places and I have to call my friend AJ and let him know a couple of things. And I didn't know that there were some things that we were talking about. And I had to say to him that listen, I refuse to believe that this is all that God has for me. I refuse to believe that God is done with me at this point in my life. See, we have to realize that if we are God's and God is ours, that we have to understand that our lives are to mirror not only who he is, but also the privileges and the promises that he's made. So what I'm learning is that when things don't go my way, perhaps that is in order. Because it's not my way that I want. It's his will that I'm looking for to be accomplished in my life. I think I need to say that one more time. That I'm learning to believe and to understand that when things don't go my way, it's okay. Because what God is trying to bring me to is to his will. Oh, I'm stuck on some selfish folk. Let me go to this side and try it out. That when things don't go your way, when you are tugging and pulling and wrestling, and you trying to pour your all into it, perhaps the reason why it's not going your way is because God has a better way. Let me share something with you. That what I've come to understand about life is that people say life is what you make of it. That's a tale. Life is what God makes of it, but where your faith has been deployed. There are some things that I refuse to allow to come into my ear gates and find grazing pastures in my life. For someone to say to me, you're not going to be nothing, heard that whole lot, been a lie every time. You can't do that. It's nothing but an Energizer Duracell battery for me. I'm not looking at what I can do, but I'm saying, don't you tell me what God can't do. Eyes haven't seen. What's the other part of that song? But I choose to believe. Just because you ain't seen it. And I said it just like we talk. Just because you haven't seen it doesn't mean that God can't do it. Now, here's where I want you to put this mind on, because we've been talking about resolutions and resilience. What I want you to really understand is that we have to put on a new mindset to begin to think in different forms and fashions if we're going to be progressive in the way and the will of God. Here's what I'm talking about. You got to stop looking at yourself and stop crying, woe is me, and stop wondering why this is happening to me, and stop trying to get a pity party. As I was talking to my friend the other day, I told him, I'm not looking for empathy or sympathy. I'm looking for somebody to make me own up and say, listen, boy, there's no more room for excuses, waiting, and being lazy. Y'all ain't hear me today. That it's time now to grab hold of the promise of God and begin to walk in the things of God. I'm not looking for empathy or sympathy, but I'm looking for somebody that'll be the wind in my back. I'm not telling you this just because I need an audience. I'm telling you this because I need you to help me stir the wind in my life. So for us that are really saying, God, I know so much, to be experiencing so little, we got to say to God when we talking to folk, oh, I'll make it clear. Make that the introductory statement to your conversation. I'm not looking for empathy. I'm looking for wisdom and impartation. I'm not looking for attention. And I don't want nobody feeling sorry for me. I'm looking for wisdom and I'm looking for impartation. So here we are with this story that we started with a long time ago by this fellow named Job. And Job was a friend of God's. How did Job become a friend of God? Now, let me tell you, King James Version writes him as a servant. The Message Bible writes him as a friend. And you say, okay, now, if the King James says servant and the Message says friend, then what does that mean to me? Jesus says that I call you no longer servant but friend, because a servant doesn't know what his father, master is thinking. So because I'm sharing stuff with you, then I'm going to be your friend. Now, this is what God did for Job. He recommended Job for the problems that Job had. And he recommended Job because he knew Job's heart. And he felt like Job had a good idea about who he was. And while Job was walking with God, God was imparting into Job, and Job was developing a relationship with God, so much so that Job had strange conversations and Job did strange kind of things. Friends of God, when things happen bad, they go to their friend. they turned to their friends. Job said, man, naked I came into the world, naked I'm gonna leave. Brought nothing in, ain't carried nothing out. Ended up where I started at. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's worship him. That's what Job said. The wife said, listen, man, hey, curse him, die. He said, listen, you sound like one of them old girls down the road. I'm kind of paraphrasing that. Let me put it in a different way. Job said to her, you sound like one of them women that ain't been living in this house. Every time I had a meal, you had a meal. Every time the sun came through the window, you were there with us. Every time we had a laugh and a smile, you were here with it. Every time we were pulled through, I didn't come through by myself. You were right by my side. So everything I've experienced with God, you pretty much have experienced the same thing. So why you sound like one of them women down the street? King James Bryce said, in all of this, Job did not, he did not lose his integrity. He maintained his fellowship with God. Now, here's how, I'm getting ready to do a launch pad right now. You got all that part right? Because we talked about the word of God. We talked about praying and the extension of prayer and all that kind of stuff. We talked about the wind being in your face and all that kind of stuff, right? We got that. So here we are now with the story that I skipped, where Job had three friends that came to talk to him. I love the ministry of his three friends in the beginning because they come in the ministry of silence. And I really believe that this is what the church needs to start practicing. Stop talking about stuff you can't explain. Stop trying to make sense of stuff that you don't understand. God don't need you to answer for him. I used to, when I was very young in ministry, I used to go to people's home when they had a family member to transition. I would say to the family member, oh, I'm so sorry for your loss. I stopped that because why am I apologizing for God's work? Because the Bible already told us that it's been appointed unto man once to die, then it's going to come judgment. Why am I apologizing? I empathize with you, but I'm not apologizing for the work that God is doing. I'm here to comfort you. I'm here in my presence to let you know that I'm available to you, but to apologize? No, I'm not doing that. Does it seem like I'm less empathetic? No. It means that I'm trying to say to you that as a representative of God, as an agent of God, I'm not going to come in here and give you the notion that God messed up by calling that name. Because if the preacher is apologetic, then it makes my grieving process that much difficult. I can't come to the place of acceptance if you're apologizing. Well, why are you apologizing? Are you telling me that God made a mistake? I'm not telling you that. I'm telling you that God knows what he's doing. And you may not understand it now, but a little bit farther down the road. Oh, that's a blues song. Maybe you'll understand it better by and by. I'm sorry, I got my songs mixed up. This is what we need to understand. That Job's friends came in with the ministry of silence. That's the best gift that you can give somebody. When they call you, check me out here, Deborah. When they call you, you listen. They came and they sat with Job in silence. Their presence says to Job, when you're ready to talk, we're here to listen. If you need anything, we're ready to serve. That's what their presence was all about. Then the friends got restless because they were looking at Job's calamity and they began to wonder in their mind, what's wrong with Job? Because he's been this person all these years and God is allowing these things to happen to Job. Job, what did you do? See, because when we get bad news from folk, child, how they die, why does it matter? Because when people ask me, well, Reverend Adams, what happened to him? I said the same thing, that the heart stopped beating. What you mean the heart stopped beating? The person that was in the car, automobile accident, heart stopped beating. Folk that had the stroke, heart stopped beating. Massive heart attack, heart stopped beating. COVID, heart stopped beating. AIDS, heart stopped beating. Gunshot, heart stopped beating. Airplane crash, heart stop beating. What good is going to do us to know, well, what happened? Am I making sense of what I'm saying? Job's friends sat with him, and then while they were sitting, silence got the best of them, and they started looking at Job and saying, for Job to be the greatest in the East, Because that's what God told Satan. There's none like him in all the earth. He's the greatest in the east. And all of these possessions that he got, Job understood that God keep blessing me over and over again. His friends understood it too, because they had been borrowing from Job. They had been part of Job's gleaning process. They've been the one that come to Job and said, Job, listen, my boy's in trouble. Can I get a little something, something? We out of sugar. Can I have a little something, something? Well, my farming crop didn't do so well. Can you do? And Job was like, yes, yes, yes. Job, you are blessed, blessed, blessed. Now what you do? Their inquiry got so deep until it began to vex Job. They kept pushing to Job to say, Job, what's wrong? Job was almost convinced maybe there is something wrong. If you go over the chapters about 35 and 30 and start pushing forward, you'll find that dialogue that they keep pushing Job. Well, Job, what are you going to say about your God? Is your God the kind of God that don't know your affliction? Is your God the kind of one that don't care about what's going on in your life? Is your God the one that is just saying, I'm absent-minded, that you sit here in a pile of ashes? Job, are your God really the kind of God that would cause you to lose everything in your children? And Job began to sit there and say, wait a minute. Y'all starting to make sense. See, Job used to influence them. Now they are impacting Job. Now, I didn't say influence Job. I said impacting Job. Job was sitting here wondering, now, wait a minute. Y'all saying that God is all that, and what y'all know about God, the little bit y'all know, y'all trying to say, let's put this thing, 2 + 2 = 4, and then the square root of 4, we're going to get 2. Then we're going to look at this thing right here and say, okay, Job, help me understand it. Job said, I really don't have an answer. Let me tell you one of the most embarrassing things for people who've been in church a long time and call themselves they degreed up. One of the most embarrassing responses you can give a person is, I don't know. You mean to tell me that your name is Dr. Lisa Moore and your only thing you can tell me is, I don't know. You've been in cathedral at least 20 plus years. You've been walking with God at least 30 some years. You mean to tell me the best answer you got about this God question is, I don't know? I want to tell you today, it's okay not to know. I want to tell you today, it's okay not to know. Job's friends' conversation began to put more and more pressure on Job. Until Job got beside himself and decided, well, I want to go and talk to God face to face and have God to answer me about these kind of things. Because Job began to get in his own righteousness, because God had called Job righteous, Job started feeling like, well, I'm too good to have these afflictions. You know, sometimes we get too good that we are no good. Job started listening to what his friend said. You had all this, and you saying you have no sin, and in your righteousness, God has done this to you. God has brought all this calamity upon you. You mean to tell me you lost 7 boys, 3 girls? For what? Job said, wait a minute, give me some room. Let me talk to God. And when Job began to talk to God, I want to tell y'all in this statement right here that it's okay to talk to God, but be careful how you approach it. Don't ever get your authority mixed up. You got authority over the devil, but not over God. You got authority over your children, but not over God. You got authority over your house, but not over God. Job goes to God and starts asking God, my friends, well, you should have told him, my friend told me that you do all these things, you know, and here I am, I'm only responding. And he said, Job asked, of course, God, what's up with you? I think it's around by verse number 38, 39, God started to answer Job after he heard all of Job's complaints about who he is and what he was. And God said to Job, boy, have you forgotten that I was there from the very beginning of everything that you had? Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Can I look at something real quick, y'all? Can I look at something real quick? Can I look at something real quick? Thank you for saying whatever you said. In chapter number 38, it says, then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said to Job, who is this that darkened the counsel by my words without knowledge? Gird up now thy loins like a man. And Job, let's talk. What God says to Job, I need you to answer my questions now. Listen to how God talked to Job. He said, gird up thy loins. In other words, strap up. Take the bend out of your back. Take the slump out of your shoulders. Hold your head up, stand 10 toes down. Don't you move, talk to me. He asked Job a very familiar question. Where were you when the foundation of the earth was poured out? When I declare, listen, if thou hast understanding, who hath laid the measure thereof? And if thou knowest, who has stretched the line upon it? Job, what about you? Where upon the foundation there were fastened? Who laid the cornerstones thereof? When the morning stars sing together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Job, he wanted to know, where were you? Or shut up the sea with the doors when it break forth and as if it had issues out of the womb. Job, tell me, where were you? When I made the clouds, the garments thereof, and the thickness swaddling bands for it. And I break it up and decreed places and set bars and doors. Job, where were you? If you jump over into chapter 38 and verse number 16, has thou entered into the springs of the sea, or has thou walked in the search of the depth? Job, in other words, do you know the bands, and do you know the band of it, the stretch span of it, and do you know the depth of it? See, these are the kind of things God knows. He goes on and asks Job in verse number 19, where is the way where the light dwelleth? Tell me, Job, where light comes from. What God was saying to Job is, I want to remind you of your human limitations. But I'm a God that has no limitations. He jumps over in chapter and gets down to verse number 33. And knowest thou the ordinance of heaven? Canst thou set dominion there over the earth? Canst thou lift up thy voice to the clouds, that the abundance of water may cover thee? Can you make it rain? Can I send lightning that they may go and say, here we are? He jumps over in chapter 39. Knowest thou the time when the wild goats of the rock bring forth? Or can thou mark when hinds do calve? Job, tell me what you know. 5 and 39. Who has sent out the wild ass free? Who sent them out free? Who has loosed the bands of the wild ass? Number 9. Will the unicorns be willing to serve thee and abide by thy crib? Can thou bind the unicorn with his band and his furrow? Number 13. Givest thou goodly wings to the peacocks, or wings of the feathers unto the ostrich? Job, what do you know about these things? Job, in all of his arrogance, I can see him coming to a place of humility. Job was saying, wait a minute, maybe my approach was wrong. Maybe I got out of order with God. Job begins to humble down. He goes over into verse number 40. I just want to go in verse number 1. Moreover, the Lord said, answered Job and said, shall he that contended with me, the Almighty, instruct him? Oh, the one that I created going to tell me what I am to do? In other words, Job, are you the boss of me? He that reproveth God, let him answer it. In other words, Job, don't punk out, talk. You had so much to say in the beginning, answer me. Once I have spoken, but I would not answer. Yea, twice, but I would not proceed any further. Job begins to understand, I'm out of line. Let me bring this story forth, walk with you. What God was saying to Job is this: I'm a creator. And if I'm a creator, I'm a sustainer. And I know how to protect, I know how to preserve, I know how to provide, and I know what my promises are. What God was saying to Job is that, see, you are limited, brother, but I can do anything that I want to. What God was really telling Job, you started out trusting me. You better stay right there. You better stay trusting me. Stay right there. Can I give y'all a disclaimer? And then I hit these 3 points in about 3 minutes, and then we go home. What God was saying to Job is, don't let your friends get in your head. Don't you let your friends get you bent. Don't you let your friends get you all caught up now. See, some of us got folk that's worshiping right beside us that think they know everything, that think they got all the answers, and they trying to tell you what God ought to be doing. And since you've been broke, they ain't contributed nothing, and still asking you, do you want to go to lunch? You've been having problems, and they ain't gave not one answer to one problem that you had, but they still want to get your business. They still want to know your how. They still want you to drop the dime about what's going on in your life. You've been telling them about the things that have been out of order, and not one time have they told you, come on, baby, let's fast and pray about the things that's going on in your life. And they worshiping with you. Got you on their favorite list in the phone. But haven't called you to prayer meeting yet. Hadn't called you yet and said, I read a word and your name came up while I was reading this word. And I just called to give you this word that I was reading and thought about you. God said, don't let your friends get in your ears. Not when I'm dealing with you. Not when I'm working. Not when I'm trying to prove something to you. Then what God says to Job's friends, he says that when God talked to Job, he turned to Job's friends. And he began to address the three boys and say, listen, I got a problem with y'all. I got a problem that you didn't mind your own business and you didn't stay in your lane. What do you mean by that, Reverend Aaron? Let me tell you what I mean, Sandra. That some of us need to know who we are, what we are, and we need to know where we need to stay. If you ain't been in spiritual warfare, get out of the line. Don't try to talk to me about what I need to do. If you and your husband and wife ain't got no problem, stand to the side. I want to deal with some folk that ain't getting along at home, but yet trying to make it work day after day. I need somebody to understand my plight, to know that sometimes I speak out of turn. Somebody to know that I slam doors, and sometimes I throw things and have tantrums, but I know that God is still working on me. I need some folk that's been going through some storm to be able to talk to me and tell me it's going to be all right. Right after a while, it's hard right now, and it might be dark, but it's gonna get better. You single and traveling all over the world with no children and trying to tell me how to stay with my husband, how to stay with my wife. Step back, baby, that ain't your lane. I don't care how anointed you are, but you ain't anointed for this. Step to the side. Let me talk to a woman that's been broken and put back together again. Let me talk to a woman that's been crying and a pillow been full of water and God dried her tears. Let me talk to a man that gave everything and sometimes lost everything, but God still let him stand tall and strong. Let me talk to that man. Be careful who you let get in your ears. Before you talk to me, give me some background information. Do you know the Lord? Do you call on his name? Have you ever been in a desolate situation? Have you ever almost fainted? Give me some background information on you before you talk about my situation. So when God got through talking to Job's friends, he said to them, go to Job. Why does God send Job's friends to him? Because they need to apologize for this foolery they've caused. When God sent Job's friends to him, he says, go and take an offering with you that you may offer for, in other words, that you may atone for the wrong. Some of the biggest phrase, the most difficult phrase some of us will ever say is, I'm sorry. Or that I was wrong. You know why a lot of marriages don't work? It's absent of those words. I was wrong. I apologize. Let me give you another one. This one here makes your heart flutter. You were right. Let me tell y'all men why women are right most of the time. Because they think about it longer than us. We done moved on, y'all stuck. We done went on to something else, y'all still thinking about it. Why y'all right? Because you put more thought in it. I'm just saying, that makes sense to me. Now, here we are. The first point is that you need to know that prayer is powerful. Catch that verse where God says that he sends his friends to Job. And God watches Job's response to his friends. The first thing I need you to know is that your prayers, that they are powerful. It's the most powerful resource that you have. Catch this statement I'm about to make. Prayer to a believer is like artillery to a military. Prayer to a believer is like artillery to the military. Prayer to a believer is like intel to law enforcement. You can't solve a case if you don't have the facts. A door won't open unless you talk to God. God sends Job's friends to them, and he says to them, Job, there they are. And Job prays for his friends. Catch that verse. God turns Job's captivity when Job prays for his friends. If you can't do anything else, you need to know how to pray. Your reputation on the battlefield ought to be that, listen, we'll win as long as we can keep him from praying. Because if that joker start praying, we gonna start losing. Don't let him go on his knees. Don't let him bow his head. Don't let him open his mouth up with the light of hope. Because if he does, everything is getting ready to shift. You ought to have the record that, listen, if it gets to Sharetta's ears, that her first response, I'm talking about first responders, her first response is, let's pray about it. Her record and reputation is that she takes everything to God in prayer. It doesn't make a difference how small it is. It doesn't make a difference how large it is. But her counsel comes from God. Not only does her counsel come from God, but her guidance comes from God. Our reputation is that, listen, before I answer, let me pray. Before I act, let me pray. Because I need to know what God is up to in the next move. Let me tell y'all something why this is so important. Watch this now. The reason why this is so important, I got to quit too. The reason why this is so important is because here's the thing. God got to be able to listen to your prayers and understand that your prayers is not selfish, that your prayers surround, that you got the ability to pray for the people that surrounded you with negativity, that gave you bad advice, that led you down the wrong road, the folk that almost made you commit spiritual suicide. You got to be willing to say, I got a heart to pray for you. Because what God wanted to see in Job, that Job understood that my friends need help. Everything ain't what you call it. You know how we go to digging in private. Girl, you know something wrong over there. Just look over there. Baby, what's wrong is maybe you need to wash your eyes. Maybe you need to change your thoughts. Maybe you need to be renewed on the inside. Not everything is subject. Everybody that's questioning everything, it lets me know something about you. So he tells Job to pray, and what God does is listen to Job's prayer. I don't know what Job prayed, but I think it was something like this. God, I thank you for my friends that you sent my way in my time of dire need. I thank you for sending them, God, and allowing them to sit with me through what I call my bad times. And God, I thank you for giving them a heart for me that they were so concerned, even so concerned that they spoke out of turn. I still want to thank you for them. I want to thank you for their life, that their love for me, it runs so deep, even though it pushed me to question you and begin to doubt you and begin to wonder, what are you really up to in your working miracles in my life? God, because I lost everything, you still gave me life. You still gave me another day. You still gave me opportunity after opportunity. Every day you woke me up was a brand new opportunity. No, I wasn't in the best of health, but every day you gave me was a better day than the day before. I want to thank you for these friends. I want to thank you for these friends that made me think twice about who you are, but for you calling me back to who I really am. I thank you for allowing these kind of things to happen in my life, because God, it's my friends through their conversation, even though they don't make sense, that have strengthened my walk with you. It is my friends' conversation that made me call on you, that made me approach you, that made me kneel down to you, and your response to me made me become humble in your sight. I thank you for these kind of friends. So not only am I asking you to bless me, but I want to put my friends in front of my asking for myself. I want to ask you, God, to bless them and to forgive them, because after all, they did bring sacrifices. I want you, God, to atone them for the things that they have done. I want you to make it right with them, because Job ain't got around to praying for himself, yet he praying for his friends. And when God began to hear how Job was praying, God was pleased. You mean to tell me that you got this much fervor for a friend? For friends that told you wrong, and for friends that led you wrong, for friends that got you caught up in the wrong concept? For friends, let me break it down to today's thing. The friends that got you at the mall knowing you can't afford to be out here. For friends that's asking you to go out and keeping you out all night long and know you need to be at home with your family. But y'all out here at parties and clubs and doing things. For friends that won't believe that the promotion that's next up, you can do it. But they're saying, child, don't worry about this stuff, like, because ain't nothing like that ever going to happen to folk like us. Them kind of friends that always borrowing from you because you're a line item 3 in their budget. For the friends that never tell you anything positive, they're always pulling on your spirit and your strength. But you're praying for them. For the friends behind your back that's telling their other friends all your business. And they're looking at your walk with God and saying, look at her, keep going up the 428 West Northside Drive. What make her think God gonna bless her? She ain't going up there for nothing. She might as well hang out with us and drink mimosas and have brunch. But you're praying for that friend. You're praying that God will open up their eyes, and that God will save their heart, that God will give them a breakthrough, that God will give them a promotion, that God will bless the work of their hands, that God will give them advances in their pay, that God will strengthen their health, that God will open their eyes, that God will renew their mind, that God will bless their families, that God will heal their disease, that God will do wonders in their life. God is listening to your prayers that you're praying for your friends. God is listening to the prayers that you're praying for your enemies, that God, I want my enemies saved. I don't want them to die where they are, but I want them to be saved. Even though my boss is giving me fits and my boss has lost her mind, I want to thank you for my boss, and I want to thank you for their salvation. I believe today that you will do it. God is listening to your prayers. Why would God want to hear Job pray? Because he heard Job pray in chapter 1, and God wanted to hear that same kind of prayer language. The second thing you need to know is that forgiveness opened doors. Job had to forgive his friends. And the next line in that verse was that God, he released Job's captivity when he prayed for his friends. And he also gave Job twice as much than he had given him before. That statement is so powerful. I gave Job twice as much as I, God, had given him before. God added more to Job on the second round than he did. See, what we have to understand is that our forgiveness is not about other folk. Our forgiveness really is about us. What God was saying to Job is that when you learn to let your friends go, that's when you're really free. When you let folk go, that's when you really live. You can't really live until you're free from all of the pain and hurt that people have caused in your life, and you say to them, you know what? It's okay. I'm not okay, but I'm going to be okay. Forgiveness opens doors. You got to know that, listen, it benefits you nothing at all to keep holding on to that grudge. And to see, Job could have went around and saying, man, Elihu them and all these guys, Zophar them, they gave me all this bad news, and I ain't gonna never have nothing else to do with them, because they was all blaming me that I had messed up in sin and talking about who I am in God and joking about my relationship with God. I don't need these kind of folk in my life. Y'all know how we cut them off. If I don't see you another day, it's too soon. But God is saying, forgive it so you can live. It's lighter to let it go than to hold on to it. Look at your neighbor and say, release. Release it. Let it go. Let it go. That's what God was trying to get Job to understand. You can't be free until you let them go. You can't live until you let them go. You won't know liberty until you free yourself from these types of baggages. And the last thing I want to say is that your best is in front of you. Round about verse number 13, I believe it says, God says that Job's ladder exceeded his former. Let me tell you something. I'm expecting great things. It depends on what you're looking for. Because if you're looking for ordinary, you're going to get ordinary. If you're looking for average, you're going to get average. But if you're looking for overflow, you know, you better know God's going to do that. I mean, you need to know that God is going to do it. And that God is going to make a way and God's going to work it out to your good. Job's ladder exceeded his former. The best is out in front of you. You need to let your neighbor know that where I am right now is nowhere near where I'm going. Stay with me, stay with me, stay with me, stay with me. Where I'm going is so much brighter than where I am. You haven't seen the best me yet. You haven't seen the greatest of my blessings yet. You haven't seen all that God can do with me yet. You have not seen that. You have not come to understand what God is doing in my life. It looks like God is not on my side, but what God is doing, God is shaving some things. It looks like God has denied me, but what I want you to know is that God is trying to deliver me. God is trying to get some folk out the way. God is trying to get some things out the way. God is trying to get me out the way. That's why these hard times are here. So we need to understand that God sometimes calls us to a win. To prove to us, I'll pull you through it. God sometimes calls us to a win. To let us know you have no reason to be afraid. Because what you got to understand about the devil is your accusers stand before God day and night. And when he says to God, you made it too easy. That's why they're with you. Well, God said, that's a lie. I allow sickness to come. I allow lost jobs to come. I allowed them to be on unemployment. I allowed them to go to public assistance. I allowed them to lose loved ones in their life. I allowed them to cry at night. I allowed them to go through things and feel like there was nobody on their side. I allowed them. So you can't give me that. Life was too easy for them. But what you don't understand, Satan, is that when I brought them to the wind, that they were able to face the wind. What you thought was that you lost it because you wanted to be by yourself. But they knew that they could not make it alone. So they hung in there with me. So when they came to their wins, they knew that I would bring them through. And just like Job, when I turned it around, the wind that they came through became the wind that pushed them forward. Y'all ain't hearing me today. When you learn to face the winds of your life, when God brings you to your exodus, God turns it around. And God allow the wind that you face be the wind to be your force. The wind that was in your face will be the wind that will push you forward. All you got to do is hang on in there. I wrote this morning on this balloon. Say it. Say it. Say it. I'm healed. Say it. I'm prospering. Say it. I'm in overflow. Say it. I shall not be denied. Say it. It's getting better. Say it. My children, they are saved. Say it. Say it. Come on. Whoever had me last week, come on. Say it. This too shall pass. I get bent out of shape. I get turned around sometimes. My mind get confused and I get all bogged down sometimes. But I say his word is true. I shall have what God say I should have. Yes, I'm bent out of shape. Yes, I don't look like myself. No, it seems like everything is out of control and I'm not going to make it. But I want to let you know that I turn it over to the Lord. Why are you broken? Because I gave it to him. Yes. Why are you crying? Because I gave it to him. Yes. Why you look like you're lonely? Because I got rid of everybody else that didn't matter. Yes. And the things that were no value. And I'm claiming only him. Yes. Let me tell you something. When you go through life, it looks literally jagged. Yeah. It looks really crazy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because you're being talked about when you used to be talked to. Now you're being talked about. You used to be the person that they laughed with. Now you're being laughed at. All that happened was life. All that happened to you was life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Not because you were bad. Not because you did something wrong. But simply God says, I trust him. In the wind. What you got to understand about the wind? Sometimes.
Look out.
The wind will get off you. Sometimes what you can't get off yourself. Can I help you with that? When you're going through a storm, count your friends. You'll find out where your weight is. Who's been holding you down? Who's been holding you back? Where are you? Because this is not a New Orleans ride. This ain't a girl's trip. This is about I lost my mama. This is about I lost my brother. This is about I lost my job. This is about that my marriage is in trouble. This is about my child is being written up. This is about my car insurance can't be paid. Where art thou, friend? And when the wind is blowing, God is saying to Satan, he ain't gonna quit. He ain't gonna quit. Because he's not alone. Where are my friends where they should be? Out of God's way. Where are the people that say they love me where they should be? Out of God's way. Because there are some things that God will reveal to you in secret that you won't catch in public. So the wind that you can stand, when your friends run away, all they saying is, I can't stand that wind. When you find yourself alone, what they're saying is, I'm not cut from the fabric that you're cut from. So you got to learn to tell your friends this. I'll bounce back. I understand you couldn't come where I am. I know you couldn't be there when I really needed you, but I'll be back. Just like old Abraham said, I and the lad will go yonder and pray and we shall return.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You got to have that kind of faith. When God is calling for you to kill what he promised, that you got to believe that God won't take it, but that God will take care of it. So when the wind in your face, when the wind in your face becomes the wind in your back, we got to understand that that's what this life message is all about. You facing it with the determination that I'm going to get through it. You facing it knowing that God is sorting and God is rationing out. You got to go through it knowing that I'm not being destroyed, but I'm being developed. God is not hurting me. God is helping me. What I like about this is that when God got ready to add to Job, he didn't send Satan. All of his brethren and all of his sisters and everybody that was acquainted with Job when things were well, everybody, God sent them to Job. And when they got to the house of Job, it said that they grieved with him. But not only did they grieve with him, they said to Job, it's going to be okay. Yes. They didn't come empty handed. It says every man gave him a piece of money. I thought my big mama was crazy. Let me get a piece of money. What God was saying was Luke 6:38. Give and it shall be given to you. Press down, shaken together, running over. Shall men, all his sisters, all his brothers, and all them that are acquainted with him poured into his bosom. They gave in small quantities of what they had, but it doubled what Job had. They gave in small quantity what they had, but it doubled what Job had. Job ended up in verse number 13, seven boys, three girls. You said Job got double, but he only ended up with seven boys and three girls. That's how he started. Those moved on. God restored. God gave him back. So if you add 7 plus 7, in all, Job had 14 boys. If you add 3 and 3, in all, Job had 6 girls. When you see me on the ground, don't feel sorry for me. I'll be back. When you see me with my head down and I'm crying and it's hanging and you misunderstand my tears that I'm on the verge of a break, I am. Breakthrough. When you see me and I make a lap in the sanctuary, don't try to calculate it. Don't try to figure it out. There are some storms you will run through. There are some storms you will stand still in. But you better know that God is doing a work all of the time. So this morning, I had an hymn. That came to my mind. I don't want to sing it. But what that hymn said to me is that when all else fail and rubber meets the road, who do you want by your side? And I end up singing a hymn, Dennis, walk with me, Lord. Walk with me. I need Jesus to walk with me. And when things get bad and I'm sometimes confused, I need him to hold my hand, Lord. Hold my hand. I need Jesus to hold my hand. Folks, that's my time. Thank you for yours. I pray that when you look in your storm, that you see the presence of God and know that whatever happens to you, that you will always bounce back. You may get stretched, you may be torn, but when it's all over and said at the end of the day, you will bounce back.